Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to yet another segment of Asaph Cafe. I am your host, Asaph Adonai, and we have our regular back, the lovely Linda Bricks Curtis. She's been gone for a while, and we're very happy to have her back. And then we have Emmett, affectionately our aging rocker.
Yep.
So we're back on our Lawrence Welk set.
Yep.
And this taping here is show number 93, because on the 28th of this month will be our 100th episode of Asaph Cafe. So we want to make it really special. And I'm just thankful to the whole entire MCAT staff, studio, people like yourself, Linda, and Emmett, and all the rest of the people who've helped me with this show in the last almost 2 years now since we've been doing it. And show number 100 is coming.
Yeah, wonderful.
All right, Emma, I'll let you start us off.
Thank you, O God, for the show. Bless our time together in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. So now that we've got that double prayer on there, I just love this song. I decided to open it with that song instead of the Burt Bacharach "This Guy's in Love with You." And I can't believe it that I'm approaching my 100th show. That is a lot.
Congratulations!
Yes, so by on the 28th of this month.
That's amazing.
Congratulations to you and
the
MCAT.
Yep.
Yeah, and I'm just again expressing my gratitude to everybody. You know, when I first did this show, it was just two brick walls. Almost 2 years ago,
but
my
you
very
had
first episode.
Cary Grant and
had Cary Grant and Audrey Hepburn. I think it's the actress.
Not Audrey Hepburn. Catherine Hepburn.
Hepburn. Yeah. Well, what? One of those. Yeah. So anyway, this show has grown, and it's been fun to have had people appear on this show, the guests that have been on here. And one person I want to acknowledge is Professor Robert Green at the university. He's been watching this show, and it was fun having him on last year when we did those two shows. And he sent me a message just last week saying he had missed you. So we're glad you're back. I'm glad you're back too.
Yeah.
So Professor Green, if you're watching this, Linda's back. And
Well, when I was a child and through high school, I grew up in a central Montana town. I used to get bronchitis nearly every winter at the break between winter and spring. And it seemed like nothing helped. I just had to get through it. And then, we didn't use antibiotics then. But I'd get through it. Just in time. So that's what happened this year.
Well, I'm glad.
Well, I have the kind of similar. I was on antibiotics, but the antibiotics didn't help. That was in January, where I just couldn't come all January. But then later on in March, or was it April? No, March. I had that flu that was going on for a week. I had to go to the doctor. It felt like a bronchitis. I thought I was going to need antibiotics. Thankfully, I didn't. It was just a viral infection that I'm finally over, and they gave me some testosterone for some other things. Because I was living on orange juice and cough syrup, so one of those things, you know. So, yeah. There's something going around, you know. Yeah.
Madam Butterfly. You recognize?
Nope.
Do it that way.
Mm-hmm. interesting, yeah.
And here's the conclusion.
The big guns come out.
Mm-hmm. Style.
Yeah.
That's an idea.
And here's the conclusion.
Mm-hmm.
So that is One Fine Day, Madam Butterfly. Are you familiar with the story of that, Emmett?
No, I never heard of the story, no.
Well, in short, basically, Colonel Pinkerton, he's a military man,
mm-hmm.
and he has a relationship with Madame Butterfly, and then he leaves her behind,
mm-hmm.
and he goes back to the States, and she's
mm-hmm.
like distraught,
mm-hmm.
missing her lover and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And finally, when he goes back to find her, she commits harikari,
they call it,
right when he finds her.
Oh!
And we were just talking about Madame Butterfly on Wake Up Missoula just yesterday, and Noel called him a jerk.
Yeah.
Well, she could sing it, I'm sure.
No, I mean, you know, just the storyline of how he treats Madame Butterfly. So.
Yeah.
That's a short gist of it.
Part
there's
of
more
the story
to it.
Also is that she had a baby boy.
Yeah, I know. I was just giving the short flyover version.
Yeah.
It'd take too long to explain that all the way through. But, yeah, she called him a jerk on Wake Up Missoula yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
We're just talking about that Colonel Pinkerton.
Mm-hmm.
You know, opera is beautiful music, but the storylines of some of those operas are...
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Oh, my goodness. They're just really graphic and detailed,
mm-hmm.
wouldn't you say?
Mm-hmm.
Very involving, a lot of them, except
one
time I found one called The Baker Awakens Early.
Huh.
Is that a comedy? That one?
It was some sort of love triangle, I guess. But I just thought that was so fascinating.
Yeah.
And like Pagliacci, isn't that kind of a tough one too?
Oh, yeah.
I'll do a piece of it here.
Actually, I've never cared for opera. I've heard opera, but I've never cared for opera. Never have. Yeah.
Can you imagine Caruso?
Yeah. They've even sometimes had opera here on MCAT on what's called, Performing Arts Showcase. They often have that here on MCAT. It's a program. They have classical music and opera. I've never been able to get into opera myself. I don't know why.
I like very dramatic opera, but I also like light opera.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's what I've performed in Civic Light Opera. Later Mouse,
mm-hmm.
La Boheme,
mm-hmm.
things like that that aren't
interesting.
Quite so dark.
Yeah.
Pretty.
Mm-hmm.
this is such a beautiful song.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Something like that, but yeah, when I was at the conservatory, I think I told this story. I had a friend named John who used to practice that particular Vesti Lajuba. Practice that. He liked to do his rock and roll.
Yeah, yeah.
In opera style, but then he would also
and
practice.
La Donna Mobile.
And then he would do his Pagliacci. Oh, and I used to enjoy going to that practice room, listening to that man sing that song that I just played. I mean, oh my goodness, any opera singer that could sing that song.
Yeah.
So, but you know, I told you there were a few of us at the conservatory that were rebels because we didn't want to just do Mozart all day long.
Yeah, yeah.
Classical music.
Mm-hmm.
We'll do some Sinatra and everything.
Oh yeah,
else.
Yeah, yeah.
And I think it's cool when an opera singer can sing a song in like, you know, a Sinatra piece or something and does it in the opera style.
Mm-hmm.
And vice versa.
Yeah. But he did do Pagliacci. He did a great job of that too.
Like Jim Nabors.
Oh yeah. Oh,
Jim
my
Nabors
goodness.
Could do either one.
Yeah.
Of a hat.
Mm-hmm.
I always think of Jim Nabors every time I hear that song or play it. Because, you know, that's the song you sang on the Andy Griffith Show when he first introduced the character of Gomer Pyle.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah, I don't think anybody ever sang that song like Jim Nabors, in my personal opinion. When Jim Nabors was young in his prime, singing prime,
yeah,
I think that his version of that song on the Andy Griffith Show is the best version I've heard.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. Yeah, they had a scene where the choir. Did you see that episode? The episode is called "And the the Song Festers." Is the name of the episode, and they had a scene where Barney Fife was supposed to be singing the solo. And we know how Barney Fife, poor Barney, everybody picks on him. Anyway, he was going to sing the solo. He couldn't really sing it very well, and so they were practicing in the choir room. And Jim Nabors' character Gomer Pyle was fixing the tire outside. He heard them singing, so he started singing along with it, and all that baritone voice. Yikes.
Wow.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
Just makes you want to melt. So they all overheard him singing that, and that's how he became the soloist.
Yeah. I never really watched the Andy Griffith Show.
Well, you know what's funny about that show? It always had like a fun little message.
Yeah, yeah.
And so, like in this episode here, when Gomer Pyle gets to be the soloist, he didn't realize how important that was to Barney. And he saw Barney sitting there in the room feeling all sad. So what Jim Nabors' character does, he pretends he has laryngitis so that Barney could get the opportunity to sing the solo.
Yeah,
so that's what I mean with that Andy Griffith Show. They just always had these little fun little
messages.
Yeah, and stuff like that.
Yeah,
morals, yeah. And so right when Barney's getting ready to sing, Gomer goes, "Good luck, Barney," kind of thing. And so then he realizes he was faking it just so he could sing the solo. And so as a result, they all sing the solo.
Interesting, yeah.
Well, I think back when those were playing for the first time was probably in 1962.
Yeah, 1962 is when they started that.
And we always had school activities and things during that time on weeknights.
Mm-hmm.
So I didn't get to see too many of those because I was in many activities.
Oh, yeah.
But I saw a number of them in reruns later.
Oh, yeah.
Which is when you must have seen them.
Yeah. Sorry about the stumble there, but...
Oh, my goodness, that's so minor.
Mm-hmm.
Would you please pass me the coffee?
Oh, certainly.
Thank you.
So anyway, getting back to the Andy Griffith Show, that show was so fun because it had morals. And, you know, speaking of the Andy Griffith Show, I did a story on Wake Up Missoula yesterday on Ken Berry. Do you remember Ken Berry?
Wasn't he a producer?
No, the dancer, Ken Berry.
Oh, yes, yes.
And he also played Mayberry RFD after Andy Griffith left the show. Then the show continued with the same principal players, but instead of Andy Griffith, they had Ken Berry. And Ken Berry played a character called Sam Jones, who was a widowed farmer. So they changed the name from the Andy Griffith Show to Mayberry RFD. And here's the theme to it. That's the theme song to Mayberry RFD. So anyway, Ken Berry took over, and I did a story on him just yesterday. He was known for his skilled dancing. You may know him on when he was older. He was on a television show called Mama's Family with Vicki Lawrence.
Never saw that one either.
I remember him from that.
Huh?
Yeah. Well, most people will probably associate Ken Berry with that character, Vincent Harper. But as a young man, here's a layout of some of his shows. You know, here's how he got started, pretty much. Ken Berry, right after high school, he was in the Army, in the Special Division, the Armed Forces, Special Services, they called it.
Special Forces?
Yes. And his sergeant was doing some Army shows at that time. And so his sergeant put Ken Berry in one of those shows, and Ken Berry won first prize. So the Army sent him to New York to appear on a show called The Arlene Francis Show, and he was a hit.
Wow.
And then in his second year, his sergeant, again, was hosting shows, emceeing and hosting and writing shows, and so they entered Ken Berry into this show again, and he wound up taking third place. But this time, what his sergeant did was contacted the major studios in Hollywood, because they had him booked on the Ed Sullivan Show. And so his sergeant says, I want you to watch this young soldier on the Ed Sullivan Show. He contacted all the major studios, and they watched. And that's how Ken Berry got picked up, and he became a bigger hit after that. And guess who his sergeant was?
Who?
Leonard Nimoy of Star Trek.
Amazing.
Talk about a small
world.
Yeah, Sergeant Leonard Nimoy, before he became Spock, he was emceeing shows for the special...
Wait, I did not know Leonard Nimoy was a sergeant in the Army.
He was a sergeant in the Army.
I did not know that.
And this is way before he became Spock.
I did not know that. Yeah, that's amazing.
He was hosting these Army shows, and Ken Berry just happened to be the one that Leonard Nimoy singled out and targeted. And so when Ken Berry appeared on the second Army show, he did a little tap dance routine.
And
of course, all the major studios were watching because Leonard Nimoy had contacted them. and told him to watch Ken Berry on the Ed Sullivan Show,
mm-hmm.
and he was a hit.
Mm-hmm.
But what's really interesting about the career of Ken Berry, you know, his dancing, because my parents used to watch him when I was a little boy, and I remember, wow, that's how I'm familiar with Ken Berry, when he was in his heyday. And he did a show called F Troop. I don't know if you ever heard of that
I've
show.
Heard of it. I've never watched it.
F Troop was a...
I remember that.
It was kind of a Western spoof of a comedy show.
Mm-hmm.
And Ken Berry's character played this accident-prone captain on the series. And also, he did the Mayberry RFD around that time he was doing F Troop.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Mayberry RFD was a continuation of the Andy Griffith Show,
mm-hmm.
where they had Ken Berry on there. And they changed it to the, as I said, to the Andy Griffith Show, to Mayberry RFD. And they had like Aunt Bee and all the rest of the people on there. And then, what's interesting, you might really find this interesting, there was another series, it was a spin-off of the Brady Bunch called Kelly's Kids.
Oh, I never heard of that. Nope.
When the Brady Bunch was in its finality and, you know, about to go off the air, they featured Ken Berry on the Brady Bunch. And it was where he was adopting three children. One was white, one was Asian, and one was African-American. And Ken Berry was the father to this family, integration family. But unfortunately, ABC was not quite ready for a sitcom of that caliber.
Yeah.
So after the Brady Bunch featured Ken Berry and his family on the Brady Bunch to introduce Kelly's kids, ABC decided not to pick up the show, which was too bad at that time.
When was that, about 1969?
Might have been early 70s when the Brady Bunch was just concluding. Probably, early 70s, maybe.
Well, they missed an opportunity.
They did. Yep. I think ABC did miss an opportunity at that time. But then Ken Berry was still doing his dancing and singing and stuff, and then he goes on to do Mama's Family when he's physically older, and the rest is history.
Interesting.
Yeah, I just wanted to share that little tidbit of history about Ken Berry.
And you know, what I've been struck with for most of my life is powerful themes, characters, and talents eventually come through and be memorable. For example, I was a voracious reader, and I was, a precocious reader.
Mm-hmm.
And when I was like in the second grade, I read Victor Hugo's Les Miserables, and I thought they should make this into a movie.
Whoa! Yeah.
And it wasn't until 1990 something. It was made into a stage musical and then a movie. And then, of course, they had made The Hunchback of Notre Dame into a movie back in the early 30s, I guess.
The black and white version?
The black and white version. But Oliver Swift, I read that and I said, this should be a movie.
Uh-huh.
And they had made movies of it back then. And Great
really?
Expectations. They had made movies of them, but they just keep coming back and coming back and coming back. And the Broadway musical of Oliver that came out in the late 60s was just phenomenal. And it continues to be so today. But, you know, you really recognize that there are some things that are always going to be good like that. And so, what I really wanted to refer that to is that later shows did make great use of integrated families to show togetherness and harmony and universal values. And so it's so sad when opportunities for them.
Yeah, and it's like we're talking about ABC. I think they missed an opportunity.
Yeah, they would have, yeah.
As you know, think of all those mindless sitcoms and movies that were made in the 1950s and some of the 60s. And you look at them now and how could anybody even watch that, let alone produce it?
That's the way it is.
Well, even in the 70s and 80s, sitcoms like, I can't even remember their names, Cheers or Friends or some of the others, like,
I was never really a... I'm not going to win a popularity contest, but I was never a fan of Cheers.
Yeah.
I didn't think that show was funny at all.
I didn't like a lot of those type of things.
I just thought it was just the stupidest, lamest...
Exactly.
...sitcom.
Yeah.
Well, it was supposed to be...
And Ted Danson is a fine
life.
Actor, because when you see him on that... what is that, CSI that he does?
Uh-huh.
Yeah. He does a
yeah.
great job.
But
and all the other
was,
people on there.
That,
yeah.
The premise of that was that it was supposed to be a slice of life. Mm-hmm.
I realize
like,
that,
yeah,
but that just didn't work
but
for me.
It
yeah.
was too realistic for you is what it was.
I just
know?
Didn't think it was funny. I mean, Sam just couldn't keep it in his pants, you know?
Yeah. yeah.
And that's as far as I got to go with that. But.
Yeah.
I'll tell you that blonde lead was absolutely fabulous.
Well, she's a fine... I'm not saying
oh,
these people aren't good actors. I'm just saying that particular show. I mean, every single one of those people on Cheers, they're all wonderful actors.
Yeah, yeah,
actresses.
They are.
And they've done better work than just that show. I just
but
didn't care for
material.
That show.
It
yeah,
was
it was just the material was not good to me.
Yeah, Three's Company was ridiculous.
Yeah,
I
didn't particularly care
I'm
for
not
that either.
That. Well, I'll tell you why I agreed with that. I mean, I identified with that because when I was in Los Angeles in 1973 and 74,
yeah.
I ended up. The best place for me to stay was the Salvation Army
mm-hmm.
residence for women in downtown Los Angeles. And there were inconvenient things about it, like you had to park on the street and move your car
uh-huh.
for a couple days, you know. And I couldn't take it to work because I didn't have parking there. The parking was like gold. But anyway, so I got a chance to move to Toluca Lake. Two guys in my acting workshop needed a roommate,
uh-huh.
and they had a three-bedroom, three-bath townhouse.
Mm-hmm.
And so I moved in with them.
Okay.
And that's all it was a roommate situation.
Mm-hmm.
But I was afraid to tell anybody.
Yeah.
You know.
yeah. So you felt like John Tripper, huh?
Yeah.
Is that
yeah.
what you're saying?
yeah. Because later, when the sitcom came, came out, I identified with
yeah,
that.
Yeah, interesting.
Well, look, I don't
yeah.
want to contradict myself. I mean, I may not have been a fan of Three's Company, but I admit there were some scenes that I did see that I thought were pretty amusing.
Yeah, amusing.
Like you were saying, John Tripper's character was trying to cover up living with two girls, and he was there to save money on his rent.
Yeah.
There was nothing sexual, but see, the thing with that show is it always had these overtones to it.
It did, yeah.
Even though there was nothing going on.
And it was...
And they were hiding from their landlord, Mr. Roper.
Double
entendres
and things like that.
It had all those overtones in that show.
One comedy I did love from the 70s, Mork and Mindy.
Yeah.
That made me laugh so
that was
much.
Funny.
Yeah.
Robin Williams was at his best.
Yeah, he was.
Oh, my goodness.
What was it, Pamela Dawson?
Dawson.
Yeah. Anyway, they both played off each other very well.
Excuse me.
But of course, he was the stronger.
Well,
super,
that show was centered
super
around him.
Yeah.
You know,
well, you know how that
wit.
Show got started, don't you? Mark and Mindy came from Happy Days with Henry Winkler.
I did not know that.
Yeah, they had this episode where Mark was sent back into the 50s in
yeah.
the time where Fonzie and those guys were.
I remember that one.
And Fonzie thought that this character was just so strange.
Yeah.
The number of those actors in sitcoms stemmed from the movie American Graffiti.
Yeah.
Which I knew Harrison Ford.
Mm-hmm.
He was in my acting workshop.
Mm-hmm.
And I didn't get very well acquainted with him or anything. But I knew that's what his stage name was.
Harrison
his
Ford?
Real name was something else.
Yeah.
But all of those people who were in American Graffiti later went on to successful careers.
Yes, Cindy Williams was in that. She did well with Laverne and Shirley.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, Ron Howard.
Oh, Laverne and Shirley was another stupid show I didn't like. I just
well,
didn't like
Cindy
those
Williams.
Guys.
Cindy Williams did Soar from American Graffiti. She was
uh-huh.
in that. She played Laverne's roommate. And of course, Ron Howard.
The Golden Girls.
He's like iconic, you know.
I love Ron Howard.
Ron Howard, everything that man touches
and
turns
Ron
to gold.
Ron Howard has a home in Big Bear Lake, California.
Yeah. The Golden Girls I did not like.
I love Ken Howard too, but he just passed away last week.
Oh, whoa. And And I definitely did not like Happy Days. I did not think Happy Days was funny. I've tried to get into Happy Days.
Well, here's my take on Happy Days.
I like the parents.
I think the Happy Days is a fine show if you're into that. But as an African American, I always have trouble watching Happy Days. Not because it was not a good show, but because...
Were blacks included?
Well, not just that. If you lived in that time zone, mm-hmm. that time period as an African American, you would have had a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And they had this episode that caught my attention where, you know how Fonzie is so cool?
Yeah,
everybody
I never
does
was
everything
by
he wants.
Yeah, I
well, they had this episode where they had a band. Richie Cunningham had a band, and uh-huh. it was an African American drummer, and Fonzie thought the band was the greatest thing. But, you know, Ralph and Potsy and all the rest of the gang, they couldn't go to that party because of the African American drummer. Their parents told them they couldn't go. That didn't
yeah.
sit well with Fonzie, so
yeah.
he threatened to beat up everybody if they didn't go to that party.
Yeah.
But see, Fonzie had to learn a lesson that prejudice is stronger than cool.
Exactly, it is, yeah.
And so that particular episode, I made an exception. I thought,
yeah, that sounds nice.
But,
yeah.
you know...
Yeah, but the point is...
But that time period is why I had a hard time...
In showing that script, they mm-hmm. were making a point. They
yeah,
were
and
yeah.
I realized that, and Fonzie had to learn that even though
yeah.
he's so cool and everybody adores him... Prejudice is prejudice.
Yeah.
That's something Mr. Cunningham had to teach Fonzie at the end of that episode. Because
yeah.
Fonzie could not understand why people didn't want to go to this party because of an African-American drummer who drummed very well.
Yeah.
But if you, beside putting that episode aside, just the whole concept of Happy Days, it was always hard for me to watch it.
Yeah, yeah.
As
well,
an African-American. Not because the show wasn't funny or wasn't
well, I didn't
funny.
Think it was funny. I
well,
didn't.
But
on a related note.
That time period.
Yeah.
It was 1984, when my son was about a year old, I bought him a miniature trap set.
Uh-huh.
With symbols and everything, and he was just going at it. And, we had it outside one time, and a neighbor lady said, "Well, I never saw a white child with such rhythm before."
Yeah, see, that's kind of offensive.
Yeah, it is. It
because
and I went, well.
It puts everybody in the category. It's like if you're an African American, you're supposed to be able to dance very well. See, that's
yeah.
very offensive.
It
I
is. It
laughed
is.
Laughed at her.
Because, you know, when you look at Ken Berry, he's not African American, and this guy was considered one of the best tap dancers and physical dancers in history. You got to see the clip.
Interesting.
Oh, really got to see
Fred
the
Astaire.
Clip. Yeah, Fred Astaire. Oh, speaking of Fred Astaire,
his
teacher, one of his teachers was a friend of mine, a guy named Willie Covan,
uh-huh.
was Fred Astaire, one of Fred Astaire's teachers. The only reason why Mr. Covan wasn't featured in pictures is because of the relationship between the studios and black and white people at that time.
Mm-hmm.
But Fred Astaire was a fine dancer. He was probably a very nice person, but... Willie Covan, I used to
well,
go to his home.
He was
in his 80s
like
when I knew him, and he would tell me all kinds of stories about Fred Astaire and teaching him and
yeah.
and stuff like that. It was cool. And when I went to his home, he'd have one of those wooden floors where he used to practice his own tap dancing, and it was always amazing to watch this guy do that.
Well, I've just always thought, and this is why I didn't watch these sitcoms even when I was a kid. Imagine if it's August, it's broiling, it's humid, you don't have much air conditioning, and the only entertainment... is this like Three's Company or Cheers or, you know, or the Golden Girls? Like, this is all we have to watch.
You can
it's
also
broken.
Always read.
That's what I would often do.
I mean,
or watch other things. Yeah,
Sam
exactly. Yeah. That's what I would do.
Or anything like that.
Read,
you know,
read the Bible,
back,
read anything. Just do anything.
Back in the Dark Ages.
Yeah.
We had radio, we had record players.
Yeah, I love you can read your record player. I mean, listen to your record player. I love my old record player still and Gordon Lightfoot.
Well, I, in 1978, I guess, tried to take tap lessons at Step Brothers Academy in Las Vegas. And the granddaughter was trying to put me through some rudimentary lessons, but I didn't have anywhere I could practice, really, and I never did.
Oh, you mean for tap dancing?
Yeah, I didn't ever get the feeling and the balance of it, but I certainly had the rhythm, because that was still the time when dancers from the big shows on the strip used to ask me out, and all they were interested in was dancing with me, because I was so light-footed they could just throw me over their shoulder.
If you were younger, do you think you would be able to... do Dancing with the Stars when you were in your prime? Do you think you would have been able to do that show? Are you familiar with Dancing with the Stars?
Yes, I am. I'm ready.
You think you would have been able to do that? You
was that limber.
Yeah, I think you would
have. I didn't have a lot of training.
Well, I think they train you on that show.
Yeah, I was never a fan of Dancing with the Stars. I've seen it. I've got relatives who just love that show. I couldn't get into it. I would even record for them when they were
addicted to it.
Yeah, I know. Some people love it. I just, you know, what was, you know, the point?
I can live with or without it, you know.
And that, same with me. I just, you know. One so-called, and I'm not going to win a popularity contest with this comment at all. You know how Seinfeld, everyone thought Seinfeld was hilarious? I thought that was one of the worst shows I've ever seen in my life. It
really?
Literally was a show about nothing.
You probably aren't going to get a popularity contest with that one.
No. It just
that
wasn't funny.
That goes along with the non-hero trend in literature and theater and existentialism.
Yeah.
And that's really what it was, kind of existentialism. I think there
you
was...
You talked about Seinfeld, right?
I think there was some very nice, subtle, and wry humor.
Mm-hmm.
And not so... There was some very over-dramatized stuff, too.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see that much of it.
Yeah, I didn't watch it all the time.
I've tried to watch it, and I've never laughed. The closest I ever came to laughing was there was one episode about this clown who was going to give appear at a birthday party for kids, and he kept saying, "I don't do bozo. I don't like being a clown."
Yeah, so, that was based on Pagliacci, I think, if I remember
really?
That right. Yeah.
That episode?
That episode, yeah.
Yeah,
the
and
clown.
There was this
fight.
He was Pagliacci
the clown, and he didn't want to do, if I remember that right, he didn't want to do children's.
Yeah. And then there was this big fire at the end, and they all had to get out, because that was the closest I came to laughing.
Yeah.
But I didn't even...
Well, you know, I think television shows, it's just an individual thing. Like, some shows that I didn't care for, others like.
Yeah.
And I'm sure someone else I like, others probably didn't care for. So I'm not picking on these shows.
Right.
Say I didn't care for it. It just wasn't for me. Happy Days was not for me.
Well, you know, I never made any of those shows. I did do a lot of extra work on them, and they'd always pull me up forward.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I kept thinking, they're going to give me a line so I can get Screen Actors Guild.
Yeah, and you get so close, right? And
yeah.
But I did do, in 1980, a long run of a show based on solo songs from Jacques Brel, the Belgian singer, songwriter, artist, musician, who wrote quite a number of songs in Paris after he had to flee to Paris from Belgium.
Mm-hmm.
And I found them to be very interpretive and heartwarming, but you know, we had a small cast. I think we had five people who were the singers, one person who played piano, and another one who was multiple percussionist. And we performed 9 weeks off the Las Vegas Strip. And
so you were actually part of that then, right?
Yeah.
That's cool.
The performers who were in big shows on the Strip would come over between their shows to watch us.
Uh-huh.
And they'd come over and over and over again. And one song that I did that many people liked really well was a song called Old Folks. And I thought, wow, that's kind of morbid. I was assigned to do it.
Okay.
And so that doesn't remind me of my grandma. My grandma was out there getting the Jefferson Award, and in her 70s, volunteering to help old people, you know. But people would, they just loved it. So I decided I'm going to be performing it for the Missoula Manor talent show on April 18th, which Joel has graciously offered to tape.
Oh, wonderful.
And I'm going to do the whole thing, but there will be other performers.
Can you do some of it right now?
I'm going to do just one verse.
Yeah,
I was just going to say that there are some people who will be doing things like, I'm having a couple people do a scene from You Can't Take It With You. And one man is going to do the reading of a poem, some poems by William Service. And but I'm going to do Sunrise Sunset as a sing-along, because everybody
Okay, we'll go ahead and do some of it now.
One verse. Can you give me a C, middle C?
Sure. Is that the right note?
That's right.
Okay.
The old folks don't talk much, and they talk so slowly when they do. Though rich, they are poor. Their illusions are gone. They share one part for two. Their homes all smell of time and old photographs and an old-fashioned song. Though you may live in town, you live so far away when your dreams are gone. And they have laughed too much, have their dry voices cracked, talking of times gone by, and have they cried too much? A tear or two still always seems to cloud the eye. They tremble as they watch the old silver clock. When day is through, it tick-tocks so slow. It says yes, it says no. It says, I wait for you. That old silver clock that's hanging on the wall, that waits for us all.
That was fantastic.
Well,
I don't know that song.
I'll be able to
do
it.
Well, yeah, and it'll sound a lot even better. Not that that wasn't good. I mean, when you have your accompaniment and all that,
I would
imagine.
And it's so poetic.
It is. It's wonderful.
Yeah.
You should hear the rest of it, but I'm not going to do it right now.
I can imagine. Well, when are you scheduled to do that? Do you know?
It's April 18th.
Well, you heard that, ladies and gentlemen. She's
going to
be singing. And where's it? Why don't you look in that camera and tell them where, give them the details.
Well, it's not really for the general public.
Yeah.
Oh,
and there
I
isn't
see.
Admission charged or anything like that. And it's just amateur talent.
Mm-hmm. It's just for the people at the manor there?
Basically for the people at the manors. I thought that, you know, they know Asaph, so he could show up and it wouldn't be any problem. Or Emmett too. It's really for the people
at the manor.
At the manor, and it's for, you know, so many people are talented in so many times.
And say the date again and the time. Do you got the date and times?
It's April 18th.
April 18th?
Monday, April 18th at 7 p.m.
Okay, at the manor. So if you're there, ladies and gentlemen, well, not the public, but the...
Yeah, interesting.
The people at the manor
will be there, so...
Yeah, they'll probably watch this. That will remind them.
Yeah, okay, there you go. You got to get a copy
interesting.
Of the show today anyway, so you got to remind them. So you people at the manor... Be there at that talent show that you're going to have on the 18th and watch Linda in action.
Yeah. Not me. Everybody who's going to be in it. We're going to have a couple of piano players, some people reading poetry.
That sounds like that's going to be a lot of fun.
A woman reading a short story to her dog.
That ought to be fun.
One woman had wanted to do the hula, but she decided she wasn't in shape to do it. I mean, she seriously had learned the correct way. But we don't have any belly dancers or acrobats, but it will be fun.
Interesting.
How much is that doggy in the window?
Yep.
Oh, that's great. Anyway,
Yeah, this is the dog Fiona. She's a white Highland Terrier. So she looks just like a black Scottish Terrier.
Fascinating.
So, anyway, so I sing her to her, "Dreaming of My Dearie" from Brigadoon.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
She likes it. She just grins.
Speaking of Brigadoon, I didn't see the whole thing, but I was channel changing just last night, and they had this one of those Vietnam black and white movies. It was pretty gruesome. I think it was called Battle of Hell or something like that. It was pretty gruesome. It came out around 1960-ish, 1965. And I happened to see the scene where this Vietnamese fellow was a snoozing back, right? And these three American soldiers went in there, and they grabbed his head, and they slit his throat. It was so gross, and you just see this blood just Yeah, I was like, what kind of a movie is this I'm looking at? So I changed the channel.
Yeah.
It was so gross.
Yeah.
But that's the way those movies were.
Yeah.
You know, this may sound unpatriotic, but if I were older, I don't know if I would have wanted to go over there to...
Yeah, same here.
Fight and...
Same here. I would have been protesting. I would have been having
a bunch
of
Vietnamese people.
Well,
and I know that if there's any soldiers watching this episode, they're going to be probably miffed, but, you know, I come from a military family, so I think I can say that with some kind of authority. That just wasn't for me.
Exactly.
You know, a lot was explained to me, and I don't remember the author, in a book called The Triangle of Death.
Mm-hmm.
And The Triangle of Death was really what killed John F. Kennedy.
Mm-hmm.
It was the European fight, and
mm-hmm.
this involved the French and other nations with drug dealings, heroin dealings,
yes.
and you know, from
yes.
the Middle East and the Far East, and that's really what the whole thing of Vietnam was a fight over the drug trade and the control over it. So, JFK and trying to be, help out your neighbor and this, that, and the other thing, did not realize until he embroiled the whole United States into it.
Yeah.
And that actually is where the operative came from who assassinated him.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep.
Let me see if I can get this Nightline thing, since we're talking about it. Let's see. Remember song?
Oh yeah, dun 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 dun. Yeah. I thought that was ABC World News Tonight.
It probably is.
I never watched. I still watch it. I never watched Nightline myself. You know.
Well, that's just the theme song. No, I'm not trying to get all political or everything.
Exactly.
Seeing that scene, it just makes you wonder if, at least for me, I can only speak for myself,
exactly.
if Asaph would have been willing to go over halfway around the world and do it, especially after that scene I saw.
Yeah, exactly.
Another problem I always had with military life, like a war, what if you get out there and get shot?
Yeah.
Is that really worth it?
Your point of view.
Well, I know, I'm not criticizing, and I'm not trying to get political, I'm just saying, like, they had this one guy who was doing the SOS thing, right? And he gets shot in the little barracks after they got that Vietnamese fella. And see, my point with that is, let's say I get shot. There's still going to be racism. There's still going to be all the other crazy stuff,
mm-hmm.
even though I'm gone. So is it really worth it from that point of view to go out there and, you know? But that's just something to think about. It's just I know it was just a scene in a movie, but it just got me thinking that.
Yeah, I missed the whole Vietnam thing because I was just born in 1967.
Well,
so
I was too young too, but
that was the year I graduated from high school.
Amazing. Yep.
What year was that?
1967 was the
year
I graduated from high school.
In 19, I was still in grade school then. Isn't that amazing?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
it is. Yeah, but
I'm not trying to say you're an old woman. I'm just saying that the generation difference is there.
Yeah, there are.
I do not mind admitting that I am an old woman. Mm-hmm.
Well, you're my old woman. I'll put it that way.
Well, I'm an aging rocker, so I can even kind of relate to that song about old folks because I feel that way too. I'm an old.
Well,
I'm
not exactly 20 myself. I'm pushing 60 myself.
Yeah.
So.
Yep.
You know, I mean, not necessarily look it, but yeah, I am pushing 60, y'all. So
yeah,
I think I can relate to that too.
Well, you know, I
and there's an old famous song.
Well, I was thinking about
old folks song.
Yep. Yep.
And that's a good way to end this because we're almost running out of time. We got about
I just wanted to
a few
say
more minutes left.
The reason, were you born on a Monday?
I don't know.
I don't know.
Remember
well,
that anyway.
This is something I've been saddled with all my life. I was born on a Monday, and according to the old English nursery rhyme, Monday's child is fair of face, Tuesday's child is full of grace, Wednesday's child is full of woe, Thursday's child has far to go. Mm-hmm. Friday's child is loving and giving. Saturday's child works hard for a living. And the child who was born on Sabbath day is bonny and good and blithe and gay.
Interesting.
And you know, it's the truth.
Yeah.
My granddaughter was born on a Friday, and she is just so loving and giving.
Interesting.
My son was born on a Thursday, and boy, he's always going the extra mile and doing all kinds of spectacular things. So.
That seems like the most appropriate song, I think.
And I kept saying, why couldn't I have been born on a Tuesday? I want to be full of grace.
Mm-hmm.
If I could have just waited one day to be born. But I'm stuck with always looking younger than I am.
Well, nothing wrong with that. I mean, if I live to be 100 years old, I hope I look like I'm still 50.
Yeah.
It'll suit me just fine. So, on that note, and on your little poetry there, any final
y'all
words, Emmett, you want to say?
A beautiful, beautiful week as we launch into spring.
Yeah.
And tulips and daffodils and irises and riding our bikes and hiking.
Yep.
And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, once again, I am Asaph Adonai, your host, on this edition of Asaph Cafe. And our lovely Linda Brooks Curtis is back. And affectionately, our aging rocker Emmett is with us today. Mm-hmm. So that's a good way to end out, I would think, huh?
Happy trails to you until we meet again. Happy trails to you. Here's hoping that till then. Bye-bye, everybody. God be with you.
Mm-hmm.
And so until our next show, ladies and gentlemen, Maranatha.
Yep.
Make yourself at home, and we'll rest a little bit. I'm going to start loading this and prepare for the second show.
Fascinating.
I can't do the second show today.
That's
oh, you can't? Okay.
I have to get back to the manor.
All right.
Well, thank you
Well, thank you very much. That was wonderful. Yep.
You like this song?